Jaffe has been playing golf since he was young. Golf is, in many ways, a game of discipline and determination. Tiki has both in spades. This project is an examination of golf and its history. In addition, it is a deep dive into the evolution of the sport, the physics of modern clubs, and sports psychology. Tiki's love for the game comes through in this project. Please welcome to the stage our final presenter, Tiki Jaffe.
Hi, my name is Tiki Jaffe, and my presentation is named Everything Golf. So starting off with the arc is the overarching theme that drives our project. And for this project, we had two options. We could use the arc, or we had the option to go arcless, meaning do a project that was self-driven. And the arc that was chosen was the heart. And we could use the heart in its literal form, meaning the heart in your body, or the heart that pumps blood, or we could use it in its metaphorical term, meaning grit, perseverance, etc. And we also have that third option, like I said, to do an arc of our own that instead of doing the heart arc. And I did all three of these. I used the heart in its literal term for a small portion of my project, as well as its metaphorical term. And then most of my project was self-driven with its own, with my own arc. So for my project, I wanted to learn four things, and that was the history of golf, physics of golf, how the heart, if there are any cardiovascular benefits to golfing, golfers with heart, and those are the two heart-related aspects of my project. And my goals were to learn all those things and teach them out through my presentation. My inspiration, like Mr. Jessup said, I've been playing golf for a long time. I really enjoy golf, and I wanted to learn everything I could about the stuff I didn't already know. So starting off with the history part of my project, for how long I've been playing golf, I was sort of surprised at myself that I didn't know much about the history. And so this was an opportunity to look into it, starting with the origins of golf. And the modern game of golf that we now know was invented in the 15th century in Scotland. But games like golf had been played long before then. Around 100 BC, Romans played a game called Paganica, where they used small bent sticks to hit pebbles and rocks into things. And then a game named Tree An during the Song Dynasty in China was another game like golf, where they used long sticks to hit rounded objects into holes dug in the ground. And then it was in the 15th century that the modern game of golf was invented. And it was very popular, and the first course ever constructed was St. Andrews. And golf became very popular right away, and it spread through the rest of Scotland and on to the rest of Europe and the world. So golf had been played since the 15th century, and it's now the late 1800s and early 1900s, and players are getting really good. And so we needed a professional league to hold these elite players. And that's when the United States Golf Association, USGGA, was founded in 1894. And it was a new professional league where players could pay money to get into events and win money if they did well. And there were five new host courses to this newly formed USGA. The St. Andrews Golf Course in Yonkers, New York, the Newport Country Club in Rhode Island, Shinnecock Hills in New Hampton, the Country Club in Brookline, Massachusetts, and the Chicago Country Club in Wheaton, Illinois. And those five courses were host courses for these new events. And then it was in 1901 that the PGA Tour was founded, and it was much like the USGA, where these elite players would play at events to win money. And it was another thing that helped golf gain in popularity when people realized they could win money doing this professionally. So I also wanted to look into the history of equipment, specifically the golf balls and golf clubs. And so starting with the golf ball, when golf started playing with rounded rocks and pebbles. And it wasn't until the mid-1850s where a golf ball was invented. And that's when, in 1848, the gutta percha ball was invented on your left. And it was made from the sap of a gutta percha tree, which that sap, when hardened and dried, is much like a rubber ball. And that was used as the first golf ball, and it was huge. But then, exactly 50 years later, the Coburn Haskell ball was invented, and it was a very huge golf ball that went got very popular real quick. It was the first golf ball to have a rubber core to it, and it paved the path for how golf balls could be made in the future. And then it had that rubber core, like I said, and then a thin layer of the gutta percha sap as a core. And then it also was the first ball to have a particular pattern. And you can see the gutta percha ball didn't have any particular pattern, whereas the Haskell ball did. And it was another thing that was huge, and it showed how golf balls could be made in the future and paved for them. And then the evolution and history of golf clubs. And if you see on your left, the hickory clubs. And every hickory club set was the same. A wooden shaft and a wooden head for drivers and woods, and then a steel or iron head for irons and wedges. And it was very basic. Every club was the same. And it was in the 1980s that the first metal-headed driver was introduced, and it was huge. And in those 40 years, golf clubs have come a very long way. And so we went from the hickory clubs to this driver right here, which is the Callaway Rogue driver that came out last year. And you see those two little bars, they are hidden inside the face on the actual club. And although those two bars don't look like they would do much, they do a lot. They connect the crown and the sole of the club, increasing the strength of the club and drastically reducing how much the face of the club deforms at impact. A second thing they do is it helps distribute the energy of impact of the ball across the entire face, giving control. And a third very important thing it does is it adds spring quality. And spring quality is the ability to receive any energy from the impact of the ball and release it back out onto the ball, like a spring. And so it just shows how far golf clubs have come, from the basic hickory clubs to the jailbreak club that we now have, or that's what they call it. They call it jailbreak technology, to the Callaway Rogue that we now have. And it just shows how far they've come in the last 40 years. So then, here's the heart-related part of my project, and one thing I wanted to do was look into how golfing affects heart rate, if there are any cardiovascular benefits. And I read an article by Golf Weekly, and they did a study on this, and we first had to find out what the average heart rate is when sitting or standing still. And upon sitting or standing still, the average heart rate is usually in between 60 to 80 beats per minute. And then after 30 minutes of hitting golf balls on the range, heart rate is, through this experiment, heart rate was typically in between 100 and 110 beats per minute for these participants that took place in the experiment. And the American Heart Association recommends 150 minutes of basic exercise or 75 minutes of vigorous exercise a week as a minimum. And one driver question for this experiment was, if golf does have a cardiovascular benefit, which category of exercise would it fall under? And as you can see, from the 60 to 80 beats per minute average to the 100 to 110 minutes beats per minute after hitting 30 minutes on the range, that's a slight increase, but nothing huge, and it would probably go under the basic exercise category. So not a huge cardiovascular benefit, but a slight one. And then I wanted to look into golfers with heart, and this was the metaphorical, using the heart in its metaphorical term. And on your left is Morgan Hoffman, and in 2013, he was diagnosed with muscular dystrophy, which is a disease that breaks down at muscles over time, and it can be very cruel to your body. And Morgan Hoffman still continues to play on the PGA Tour, despite this big setback, and last year he finished 82nd on the PGA money list, earning $1.2 million, which is very good for him considering he has this life-changing disease. And then this closest to me is Eric Compton. And Eric Compton didn't know a thing about golf. And then in 1992, he had a heart condition and needed a heart transplant. His heart transplant was successful, he regained his health, and he began golf as a rehabilitation method. And that's when he found his love for golf. He got very good and played on the PGA Tour, played on the 2001 Walker Cup team, and was a very successful professional. And then in 2008, his heart condition returned to his new heart, and he needed a second transplant. The heart transplant was successful again, and he continues to play golf professionally on the web.com tour. So then, another thing I wanted to look into is the physics of golf. And you can see why my project is named Everything Golf, because it's everything about golf that interested me. And as you can see in the far picture, well, I wanted to look into two questions involving the physics of golf. One involving golf balls, one involving golf clubs, and the questions being, why are there dimples on a golf ball, and why are driver club heads getting bigger? Starting with the golf ball, why are there dimples on a golf ball? So on the far picture, you can see a smooth golf ball. And when flying through the air, the golf ball will push all the air molecules out of the way, creating a vacuum or a low pressure zone behind the ball that's sucking back on the ball, making it go significantly less far. Whereas a ball with dimples, you can see there's a much tighter airflow and less of a low pressure zone sucking back. And this is due to little air molecules getting stuck in the dimples rather than getting pushed aside and getting pushed around the ball in the dimples, making a much tighter airflow and a less of a low pressure zone behind the ball. And scientists say that a golf ball with dimples will go almost twice as far as a golf ball without. And that is huge. And it's actually very interesting how we realize dimples are beneficial to the game of golf and to gaining distance. And it was back in the times of the gutta-percha ball. And people realized that as they used their golf ball more and more, it would start to go further and further. And they looked into it, and they found out that as they used their golf ball more and more, they would start dents and marks would start to appear on the ball, much like dimples. And that's, after looking into it, that's when they found out that dimples make the ball go further, which I found very interesting. So next is the physics of golf clubs and why are driver heads getting bigger and bigger. So if you look at a wooden hickory driver, a very small head, I have one right over there. Like I said, in the 1980s, the first metal-headed driver was introduced. And it had a much larger head than the hickory clubs, but it's tiny compared to clubs that are being released today. Why is that? Well, there are three very good explanations, and it is very helpful in three ways. So one, a bigger head makes you swing harder. It basically is forcing you to swing harder. The bigger the club head, the harder you have to swing it. So the bigger club head is basically forcing you to hit it harder, unintentionally. The second thing a bigger club head does is the bigger the club head, the bigger the face on the club head is. And the bigger the face, the more the energy of the golf ball can be distributed across it, giving more control. And the third thing it does is improve spring quality. And like I said, spring quality is the ability to catch any energy from the ball, impact of the ball, and release it back out onto the ball. And the bigger the head, the bigger the face, and the bigger the face, the bigger the sweet spot on the club is. And the sweet spot is basically the area in the center of the face where the golf shot will be most consistent and go the furthest. And the bigger the sweet spot is, the more spring quality it has. And those three reasons are why golf club heads on drivers have gotten bigger. So I wanted to do an experiment based off of both the history of golf and physics of golf. And so I tested the difference between a hickory club and a modern club, and I tested their ball speed and distance and analyzed the data. And so I had my grandpa send me hickory club set that he had from 1923, which was very generous of him. And they are in great condition. And I used a 7-iron from the hickory set, and then I also used a 7-iron from today. And I used a 714 AP1 from Titleist. And next slide. So I hit the two. I could only hit 15 shots with each, time permitting. But this is ball speed. And the blue is the hickory club, and the red is the modern club. And you can see a pretty big difference. The average ball speed with the hickory club was 73, and the average ball speed with the modern club was 88. And then next, I tested the distance. And again, I could only hit 15 shots time permitting. But I tested the distance, and the average distance with the hickory club was 97, and the average distance with the modern AP1 was 122 yards. And I wanted to look into why this was. And first, I think that the ball speed and distance was higher on the modern club, first because of spring quality. These newer clubs have stronger faces and more spring quality, and that could cause the ball to travel faster and further. And then another thing that I think was a big reason that the hickory clubs went less far is because of loft. And the 7-iron had a much lower loft than the hickory 7-iron. And it's like that in the hickory set, where the club in the 2-iron, say, in the hickory set was more like a modern 4-iron. And this 7-iron was more like a 9-iron. So these hickory clubs were lofted as if they were two clubs higher. And it's not just like that in this hickory set, it's like that in all hickory sets. And over time, the loft of golf clubs has gone down and down, and that's for the craving of distance. People realize, oh, if I put the loft down, it'll go further. So over time, the loft of clubs has gone down, and I think due to the big difference in loft, that can be one reason why the modern club went further. And then these are just two graphs. On the far side is just the hickory club, the ball speed, and the distance of just the hickory club. And then right here is just the distance and ball speed of the modern club. And these graphs don't look like they do much, but it actually shows a lot. So the ball speed is in red and the distance is in blue. And it shows that whenever there's a fluctuation in the ball speed, there will also be that fluctuation in distance. And that shows how important ball speed is to the distance of a golf shot. And that's why we've added so many things to golf to add ball speed, because it's sort of the key to distance. And then another thing I wanted to look into was sports psychology and golf psychology. And psychology, a sports psychologist is basically like a coach for the mental side of the game and a mental analyst for sports. And many top athletes are getting sports psychologists to help them with the mental side of the game, because many sports are mental and involve a lot of thinking, and golf is definitely one of them. And so first I want to get a volunteer up here to try to make a putt. All right, Diego. Money on the line, demotion. If they don't do well, they could get demoted down a league. And all these things on the line causes for a lot of stress. And golf psychologists work on finding ways to block out this stress and find other ways to focus more on the game. And one thing that both psychologists and professional golfers say is the most important thing on the mental side of the game is visualization. Whether it's a tee shot and you visualize yourself hitting that shot, or whether it's a tap-in putt and you visualize yourself tapping it in. They say that visualization is a very important thing to block those stresses that may be coming towards you while you're playing golf. So I'd like to thank everyone for coming to my presentation. I'd like to give a special thanks to my mom and my dad for being at home for me whenever I need help, for my sister for staying out of my hair most of the time when I'm trying to work, for Mr. Jessup being a great advisor, Pete Roche for letting me use his simulator at Sauna Out, for everyone for coming, and for all the lab students for being supportive.
When you were doing your experimentation with the hickory clubs and the current, are those titanium, what are your, or carbon fiber, what are your, the current, the shafts?
The shafts?
Yeah, what's a shaft?
So the hickory, the modern club?
Yeah.
It's a graphite shaft.
Okay, graphite. So did you feel, like, when you were, the impact when you hit it, did you feel that the graphite shaft, perhaps, did it feel different than the hickory shaft and maybe the shock or when you hit the ball?
They both felt very strong, which surprised me.
Uh-huh.
I thought the graphite shaft would be much more stronger and just feel better. But the wooden hickory, as it's in such good condition, held up really well, and I didn't feel much of a difference. I think most of the difference in the swing came from the head of the club, just the different. You could see that the hickory club is a lot thinner on the head.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't see much of a difference in the shaft.
But like shock absorption in your arms, like when you hit it, you didn't feel
a difference.
Okay.
AJ? So
when
you were measuring the ball speed, were you measuring it in miles per hour or kilometers per hour?
Yes, miles per hour.
How did you, two questions, how did you measure ball speed? Is one.
All right, so I use this thing called FlightScope, and it is this machine that measures a bunch of stuff. Ball speed, distance, smash factor, which is ball speed divided by, or club head speed divided by ball speed. It measures a bunch of things, but I use that flight scope to measure this ball speed.
So you can tell I'm not a golfer. I guess most of the golfers in the room know about that thing. And second of all, what's to keep them from making a plate size club? Is there a regulation about how big it can be? I mean, I would think to just go big.
Well, the bigger you make it, obviously, there's a point where it'd be hard to hold. It would weigh down on the shaft, making the shaft bend when you're even just standing still. And it sort of have to stop at a point where you can't really swing it anymore, and where it make the shaft really flimsy. And
is there a current, any kind of current regulation in pro golf about the size of your club?
I believe there is. I don't know what it is, but I know they have regulations on all clubs.
Okay.
For size.
Now that you've finished your project, can I have my 7-iron back?
So I used his 7-iron in the experimental process because it was more like, it was the almost exact same size as the hickory 7-iron, rather than my 7-iron was much smaller than the hickory 7-iron. So I thought if I could use two clubs that were about the same height, then I could get similar results. Spencer?
How did you make sure that you're swinging the clubs at the same speed every time?
Well, at first I was a little suspicious. I thought that these hickory clubs wouldn't be able to hold it. But after a few, they all held up really well, and I just swung my normal swing every time, no matter what club. And when I looked at club head speed for the two clubs, usually they were right around the same because this flight scope also measured club head speed, and usually they were the same.
Okay.
more than the wondering, but I took away a lot of